Modi Masimcha and Boker Tov, Rabbi Eric Solomon from the Morning Torah here in Raleigh, North Carolina. I'd like to do a very short teaching here in our sukkah. You can probably see here some decorations and things we got here, our booth of dwelling for this week of Sukkot. And I also have here, I'm happy to say my favorite mitzvot is the lulav and etrog. These are the four species that one shakes in various directions every day during Sukkot. And here's my quick teaching about particularly the lulav piece. And the lulav has three parts, but really the spiny middle, which is from a palm tree, which is very sharp at the top. And actually can point you in the Bible, in the Tanakh, there's actually stories of this being used as a sword. Don't worry, I'm not going to do that here, but it can be very strong, obviously. But one of the Midrashim describes as being like the spine, being like the body spine. And the way I put it is, it's like the backbone. So let me tell you a little bit of what my take is on the backbone here. Why Sukkot? Why after this time of year? Why do we need a reminder of the backbone and shake the backbone, but don't break the backbone? So why? So I remember when my first time going to Israel, and many of you who traveled to Israel maybe know this story, you know this place of Ein Gedi. Ein Gedi is this beautiful natural spring near the Dead Sea, has gorgeous waterfalls. It's a classic hike and classic stop for tourists when visiting Israel. But Ein Gedi historically has mentioned different times in the Tanakh, but the one that's most famous is King David. I won't tell the whole story here. You can Google it up or read it yourself. But King David basically is anointed to become the next king of Israel. But King Saul, Shaul, is not happy about it and is threatened by it, very insecure. And bottom line, basically goes to search to kill him, and with his soldiers and various things. And one of the Midrashim that's told the story is that David in his life, he at one point questions, according to this rabbinic story, what's the purpose of spiders? Why are spiders created? Do they even matter? It seems like they're irrelevant. They're just annoying, whatever. So fast forward, he's running in Ein Gedi. So we know Ein Gedi has high, steep, call them cliffs, but mountainsides where the soil is very easy, even with your hands, you can go and kind of peel away and dig into it. And there are caves there where historically people lived in these caves in ancient times. As a side issue, if you know the Dead Sea Scrolls, they're also down that area. That's one of the reasons, because the soil is able to, it's also very dry, and you actually can go and create a place for living. So there are caves on the side. King David's hiding in one of these caves. Saul and his our troops are coming to get him. He's worried, oh my God, that's it, he's hiding way in the back. And all of a sudden, a spider comes up and forms a web right in front of the mouth of the cave. King David's soldiers come up, or King Saul's soldiers come up, and they see there's a spider. They say, let's not search there. There's a spider here. Clearly no one went in there. And in that Midrash basically says, King David realizes, aha, everything is created for a purpose. Everything in nature is created for a purpose. Everything has an opportunity to learn from it in the natural world. So to extend that a little bit into Sukkot, which is the holiday going into nature, environment, going outside your house to a fragile place, I want to say we can learn something from the lulav, from the palm, from this strong thing in the middle of the palm tree. And what I would say is it's about backbone, which the Midrash says as well. It's about spine, but backbone. And why this time of year? Because after Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah, we've done all this introspection and reflection in our life and how we want to be and to be different in the new year. We've also made commitments to apologize and say we're sorry, or even to forgive others that we've held off or found it difficult to do so. The backbone reminds us, time to step up, time to follow through, time to do what's hard. You know, some people think the hard work is Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur. It's true, that period or Elul is tough because it's the introspection, it's the admitting, it's the confessing, it's coming before the community and before God and really open up your heart to that. That is difficult. But sometimes even more challenging is actual fulfillment of the ideas you come up with in Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, and then you have to actually follow through with them. I've had people tell me post-Yom Kippur that they finally realize they really need to apologize. And then after Yom Kippur, even though technically on some level the gates are closed, they feel then they go after Yom Kippur. So go in the afternoon of Yom Kippur and actually contact people that they wish to apologize to. That's why also according to tradition, is a mystical tradition, that we actually gates don't fully close until the like almost end of Sukkot, or Hoshana Rabbah. I think one of the ideas is because the lulav inspires us to do in general, to do in the world. Not just think about it, not just feel it, not just pray, but to actually do. So I hope that when we shake the lulav and also the etrog, we think about backbone, about following through. Their ideas we had, can we bring them into reality? Even when it's challenging, even when it's out in the real world of fragility and difficulty and unexpected things, this is a time. So when we shake the lulav and the etrog on this holiday Sukkot, I invite you to think about how can we bring to fruition everything? And we learn that from the palm, or on some level from the spider. Shabbat shalom, moedim l'simcha, and have a wonderful rest of the holiday. Kol tov.